artist, Justin Bell. And Justin has, of course, been very well known as a race car driver, also in his second career as a sports commentator for racing events. So we're going to talk to Justin a little bit about both of those. But first, if you would, you drove nine times at Le Mans in the 1990s. What's it like to drive at Le Mans for 24 hours?
You know, I mean, firstly, hello, welcome. Thank you, everybody, for having me. It's Le Mans, for me, maybe had a different take on it because I've been there my whole life. I was under a year old the first time I went. So by the time I first drove at Le Mans, it was probably my 30th time there. I mean, it can't have been 20th time, 22nd time. I mean, as in I was early 20s. And I, so just pulling out of the pit lane for the first time was truly outstanding to pull onto the track, you know, get the green light to go out and pull onto track where I knew every inch of as a child walking around it and going around it on a scooter and watching dad drive. So it felt pretty emotional, actually. The first few laps, I think I was struck by what a road, public road it was coming around the back onto the Mulsanne. As you shift from one side of the track to the other, you cross over the, you know, the central, the median of the road, and, you know, it kind of jiggles the car a bit, and, you know, you're on a public road. You're on the road to Tours from Le Mans. So you're quite aware that this is not a normal racetrack. But by the time you come around for the second or third time, bearing in mind you only see each corner every 4 minutes or so, which is enough time to forget what you've just done. You start to treat it like a racetrack. And in my opinion, and obviously the main part past this, the Bugatti circuit part, which is the pits and the Porsche curves and everything, that's a permanent racetrack. But you go onto the backside and you go, wow, I really am on. I was driving on this morning and I saw trucks driving down it, you know, and guys on bicycles with onions on the back of their bikes. Very stereotypical, but, you know, just that's my imagination. But it's a truly phenomenal racetrack. And because it's so long, when you think that race drivers do things by repetition, you know, we're not rally drivers. We rely on the fact that corners are the same every time you come around within reason. The fact that you only see the corners every 4 minutes means that when you're learning the track, it is very demanding. And I did it in the year before Sims. So I'd cycled it and I'd run it, and it's a long way around. But it looks a bit different when you're going at speed. So yeah, it's just an epic racetrack and definitely my favorite track.
Well, you know, you brought up something I hadn't thought of. If you went there as a very young boy with your father driving in the race, did you have any conception of how dangerous it was, what he was doing?
No. I mean, other than the fact that not at Le Mans, people getting killed in dad's era that I was, you know, cognizant of, but it was an era when I know people were dying. So we were very affected by that as a family. I got to say, my mum, especially. But all I thought was, you know, you've got the fairground where you could see the world's fattest lady and the three-legged baby and the two-headed teenager. And it was a freak show, the fairground. They even had a whorehouse in the middle of the fairground at Le Mans. Now, you don't get that at COTA, do you? You know what I mean? You're not getting that. You might get it at the Miami Grand Prix, but you're not getting that at Road America. It was a pretty raucous place with 250,000 people all camping. And this was before they gentrified it. You know, what was dangerous was not necessarily, I thought it was pretty dangerous just being a spectator. You know, you'd be out on the, the back of the pits, they had a gravel, the old pits had a little gravel sort of drainage channel going you had to step over to get into the garage, which was just full of pee. I mean, how gross is that? That's what you did. And that's not I did, was it? I guess everyone did it. So by the end of 24 hours, the risks on the off track, I think, were probably greater than on track. It was so primitive in a way, yet the best drivers in the most incredible cars were out there. But remember, I'm just telling you things that struck me as a kid. Being a driver, you know, when I was racing, I wasn't noticing those things. It had changed by then, new pits and everything. But, you know, as a kid, you're struck by the little things. My dad used to, you know, when he was with a big team, they had a little baby caravan, you know, like one of those one bed little caravans that, you know, like from a trailer park, looked like a trailer park at the back. And the fancy drivers had their own trailer. But not like a Hollywood trailer, like one the feet would, Hansstuck's legs would reach from one end to the other of it, you know. And remember, they were doing two drivers. So they, as Dad said, he and Jack, everyone says, how did you two get on? And he said, we never saw each other.
Yeah.
You know, you're getting in the car, out of the car, in the car, out of the car for 24 hours. So, you know, my era was just the beginning of when it really started changing in the 90s. But it just, well, yeah, danger everywhere, fast. You could get up against as a pedestrian, you know, as a fan, get up against the guardrail. We used to, you know, go around the gendarmes and get up against the guardrail and see the cars going by 10 feet away at 220 miles an hour. Mm-hmm. Just brilliant, you know.
Now, you drove an amazing variety of cars, but I think the majority was in the Viper. And won your class in the early 90s, along with David Donahue, who's a great friend of the museum. Tell us a little bit about that year when you guys won the class.
Well, you know, it was, I think I'd already had two podiums by that. I think one, because I'd been on the podium with the McLaren 2 years before, and I didn't think anything was going to top that. But winning your class was, you know, people say, oh, you only won your class. I go, well, that's the only race I was in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wasn't in to win it overall. So you can only win the class you're in. Unless it's an odd year and you know, prototypes do badly, then a GT car can win. David, Luca Drudi and myself in the Viper, we were not supposed to win. We were the second, if not third car of the squad. It was very much favored for the car with like Olivier Barreto and Philippe Gachin to win. But we didn't have any problems and we just kept on going around and we had the right pace and we were immaculate the whole race. And they had unfortunately problems, but that's how it goes. And so to be on the podium at Le Mans with, you know, having won in the sort of heyday of this Viper as part of an American team going to Europe, it felt like an invasion. It was very special. And the crowds loved the Viper. It made ridiculous noise. I mean, you could still hear your ears ringing a day later because, you know, it would just bounce off the pit walls and blah, 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 blah. It would sort of come back in your head. We were so fast down the straight. Because obviously these things didn't have a lot, they didn't have a lot of drag compared to the prototypes. So yeah, I got to say, I look back on it and I've got helmets behind me on there, the ones I wore and models of the car, just a very, it felt good to be part of something so big.
Now, you mentioned something that has kind of gone by the wayside in modern racing, pace. It used to be that, you know, if you wanted to win at Le Mans or Sebring or any of the endurance races, you had to pace the car and not abuse it. I was just at Sebring a few weeks ago, and that was a 12-hour sprint race. I don't think they let up for a second. Tell us a little bit about the difference in racing in the 90s when you were doing it and how it is today.
Well, I mean, it's a direct result of the sort of improvements and excellence in engineering and manufacturing that we experience today, both in our road cars and in our race cars. You know, Dad was here for the Long Beach Grand Prix and we were, we were with the RRDC, Road Racer Drivers Club guys, and just chatting. And one of the common themes, like Alvin Springer said from Andile, you know, back then you had to manage, you had to look after the brakes, you had to look after the gearbox, you had to look after the engine, you had to look after the clutch, you couldn't hit curbs. You know, you had to really manage the car. And if you did that and didn't destroy it, you know, it would, because they were so fragile, you'd have a good shot of winning. Now that those drivers are just, sorry, I got my phone's going. Drivers are just, I think they are at a different level in terms of the way they're groomed to be fast now. You know, they work on the simulators, which are so like the real cars. They've done thousands of laps before they go to a new track, which is unbelievably helpful. They have sequential gearboxes, so there's no managing the gearbox. You don't have to blip on the downshift. You can't over rev it. You'd have to really work hard to over rev it. So it's changed the whole style of everything. And at Le Mans, that means the pace has just gone up. I mean, if you're managing tires to do a triple stint, then you'll be backing off to a pace a bit. And obviously, if you've got a good advantage on someone, they'll pull you back to a pace. But you hear it in Formula One. You think the guy's driving around going as fast as he can, he thinks. And then they go, bit more effort. You know, I mean, at which point you probably want to tell them to get lost, I'm sure, you know, or words to that effect. So I think I'm quite glad I drove when I drove, because, you know, our cars were much more reliable than Dad's era, the ones before us. But we were able to, you know, we set a lap pace that they know would win the race.
Yeah. Now, you're one of the very few people who have driven with your father. I mean, Mario, yeah. A couple of years with Michael, you raced 2 years with your dad. Now, tell us honestly, were you faster than your father?
No, it's interesting. Certain moments I was, not overall. I think I had the faster lap than him in the McLaren in the morning, but in the rain, he drove so much better than I did. I was really too young. I was very intimidated. Yeah, yeah. We were on good years that weren't as good as the Michelins that the Leto car was on. I mean, you know, locking up at 210 miles an hour on the Mulsanne, you're just locking, you know, you're just trying to bring the car to a stop in the pouring rain. No, I didn't excel in the rain there. That was better. The 962, I was 20 years old, 21 years old. I'd driven a Formula Ford, and then suddenly I was in a 962 at Le Mans, you know, effectively. I actually did very well, but I was very inexperienced. And suddenly you're in 962. I've got to say, I remember a journalist said to me, "Oh, what's it like not being as fast as your dad?" I went, "Unless you've checked, nor 98% of the people in this pit lane. So don't just lay that one on me." You know what I mean? It's like, there's a lot of people in this pit lane that aren't as quick as him. But obviously, as he got a bit older and I got more experienced, my pace overtook his. Yeah.
I was a track photographer at Sebring in back in the 60s and early 70s, and I've noticed you post a lot of your own photographs now on Facebook. You'll go around and do interviews with people.
Love
it. And your photography is exceptional. How did you do? I mean, is that just something that you had an interest in and developed, or how did that come about?
Well, thank you for saying that. Yeah, you know, I was an art student. I was not supposed to be a racing driver. I should have been an actor or a producer. I wanted to be in great. I was a creative kid. I raced motocross, but I was at the same time I was, you know, life drawing. So I knew, but I was never really good enough at art, but I was very, very creative and imaginative. To be honest, that's probably one of the drawbacks of my racing career, was that I don't think drivers have great imaginations. You can't have imagination. How can you have an imagination if you can imagine what it's going to be like to go through the crowd at 200 miles an hour upside down and kill 100 people? I mean, if I could think that, and I used to think that, that's not a good thing for a racing driver to think. So I think I had the speed, but if you like, my artistic side was my drawback. However, you pack that away to be a pro, and then I knew I needed to do something creative again, and got early 40s, started trying to do some painting, but I was as bad as I ever thought I was. And then I was at Pebble Beach and I saw someone with a Hasselblad 501cm. I was like, oh my God, that, I heard it go clunk, and I went, I need that. I'm going to do that. I knew nothing about it. Went to Sammy's Camera in LA, got the camera, on eBay. They helped me choose one, and obviously secondhand. And I floundered around trying to get into film photography with no background. And of course, we were really in a point when digital was so strong, but I wanted to learn film. But then I got into Leicas, and I used film and digital. And of course, the digital helped me improve because I could see the results straight away. So I got better faster. But I realized, you guys that shoot cars, and there's a certain gift to shooting cars. We can all shoot them, but there's a look, you look at Camden Thrash or Jamie Price or any of the top guys now, Rick Doll, really good, really good. And I found my place I like portraits. And I think it's a direct extension of my ability to interview people, So my creative side came out through TV, making shows, writing shows, hosting shows. That's where my creative side came out. But the photography is just something I love so much.
I thought that shot you did of Parnelli was especially touching. And the comment that you made, that was when I think I first really recognized your whole aesthetic and what you were doing and stuff. That was, and I've seen other pictures now recently of Parnelli, and I understand. It was fantastic. Really.
Thank you. Really. Yeah, I have lots of his face, but I don't want to, it's just like, it looks like an old man, not one of the best people ever to drive a race car.
And there's so much, there's so much in your hands, especially of a race car driver, Yeah. And, that comes through. So thank you very much for doing that. And thank you very much for being here and letting us interview you for this. And please come to the museum sometime. And
I certainly am. And all I can tell you, everybody that's heading out there on the hour to drive one of these beautiful cars, make the most of it, enjoy it, because the guys at Le Mans, I promise you, aren't eating as well, drinking as well, or driving in such comfort. These athletes, as you say, the pressure on them this year with this merging of this, the LMGH GTP category, you're in for the best race in decades. So yeah. Make Can't it to the end, everybody, pace yourselves.
Thank you very much, Justin.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.